And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect 3. I'm the RPG chick, headed to... what's the name of this place again? Nubian Expanse. Pretty sure this is a new system. Obviously, we have to check it out. Daka system. We also got Kalabsha and Kirtasi. Is there any others? Nope, these three. Oh my god, we're really low on fuel. Well, let's see if we find any in this system before we go to our gas station in the Horsehead Nebula. Alright, so first planet is Bennek. Bennek is a large super-terrestrial hothouse with a crushing carbon dioxide atmosphere. A high average density of over 7 grams per cubic centimeter indicates that Bennek is a mineralogical treasure trove. If only there was some way to safely reach its seas of molten metal and loads of radioactives. The planet's mass is so great that trace amounts of helium and molecular hydrogen can be found in the atmosphere. Okay. Pragya. Pragya sounds familiar. You had a mission on Pragya? Oh yeah, I think so. Guessing too. I'm just guessing this is where we went for Zaid's mission. The jungle planet Pragya is overrun by choking hypergrowth caused by industrial mutated plant species. This, combined with its relative isolation and lack of population, has made Pragya an occasional base of operations for drug runners, weapon smugglers, pirates, mercenaries, terrorists, and intelligence agents seeking secrecy. Sustained habitation on Pragya is extremely difficult, where mutant and even poisonous plant life can overgrow colonies in days instead of years. An ice giant this close? Alkonost? Alkonos is a standard ice giant with a methane-ammonia atmosphere. It has an unusually strong magnetic field, which is occasionally useful when ships need to discharge their drives. Gamayan. Gamayan is a hydrogen-helium gas giant with six large icy moons. The outermost one, Chegila, is of note for a well-preserved wreckage of an ancient starship that was recovered by a Turian military surveyor. Little information has been released to the public on the vessel, aside from a scholarly paper indicating how the internal layout suggests a horizontally oriented race. Next, where is this? Tiny one up here. The last one. Zernitra. Cold, distant Zernitra has an extremely low density and is thought to be mainly water ice around a small rocky core. It has little to recommend it. Now what's funny is we have a gas giant this close. Methane and ammonia. I guess it depends on what it's made out of. Methane and ammonia there. Hydrogen, helium there. I guess hydrogen and helium doesn't freeze into ice like the other one does. Okay, so we're gonna look for some gas. We need gas. Our interstellar gas station. So I'm wondering how close to the end of the game we are, guys. Not that I want it to be over necessarily, but I've been playing it for a while, so naturally I have a curiosity. We're almost up to 138 episodes for the first game. Totally not finding anything. Okay. I hear a radio frequency. Remember when we used to find things that turn into quests on planets? I kind of missed that. Probe launched. Research data from Pragya. It's an unknown thingy. 50%. I want that fuel. Damn, it's gonna be difficult. Wait. Oh my god, they're coming so quick. 350 units. We're pretty close to full. Wait, wait, no! 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 Are you kidding? You kidding me? We were right at the edge of the system. We're starting over. It was somewhere around here, right?
I found something.
Okay. Fueling up. And time to go. Systems don't look that far away. What? What the? What the hell? Why did it show us going through a mass relay? We hit a mass relay to go from system to system? What the f- I'm confused. I'm a little confused. Okay, one planet in the Cortassi system. Naresha. Naresha is an unremarkable methane ammonia ice giant with a small family of icy moons. It is likely that the Cortassi system had additional worlds earlier in its history, but these have been swallowed by the aging giant star. Cortassi is an elderly, metal-poor Population 2 star, broadly similar to Arcturus. Okay. Oh!
Signal confirmed.
Okay. 50 units. That's the smallest amount of fuel, because I guess we weren't was that supposed to happen? That's weird. I'm still confused about that whole going through the mass relay to get to another system in the same cluster. Probe launched. Alliance frigate Trafalgar. Nice. And, yeah, update for Alliance 3rd fleet it's in. Cool. We're done here. Now, when we go here, are we gonna go through a mass relay? No. Alright. The Kalapsha system. First one is Yam. Yam. With over 90% of its surface covered in oceans, Yam is a habitable nitrogen-oxygen world, but its extremes can be quite hostile to sapient life. The heat from its extremely long days reaches dangerous levels, ranging from 44 Celsius at night to 53 in the afternoon in the temperate zones. Hurricanes run unchecked across the oceans, with winds reaching up to 250 kilometers per hour. While there are some arthropod-like animals, the predominant forms of life are various kinds of toxic algae blooms that stretch hundreds of kilometers across. However, other biohydrocarbon algae blooms are suitable for use as biofuel, and farming the green gold forms the backbone of Yam's economy. Colony founded in 2170 CE, population 488,504, and the capital is New Karnak. Population. I did say population, right? What was I? One more. Tefnut. It's a really tough nut to crack. A hydrogen-helium gas giant, Tefnut is home to a Helium-3 collection and the nearest refueling facility of the Nubian Expanse's mass relay. As such, it is a major gateway to the Verge and Terminus systems and has become famous for its hospitality industry. Tefnut's motto is known throughout the galaxy, like home, only better. Visitors here can stay at expansive resort stations, watch locally produced entertainment, buy mind-affecting substances not welcome in Citadel space, and rent companionship. Resources are shipped in from Yam at substantial discounts, allowing the small space stations to have surprising luxuries such as edible arthropods and large amounts of fresh water. Population is 33,810, spread across 5 space stations. Alright, we're looking for stuff. I do an experiment. Let's see if that's a one-time thing that the mass relay brought us to. It's so funny. Almost done. Totally not finding anything.
I found something.
Jeez, Reapers, relax. Probe away. Alliance Marine Recon Unit. 103rd Marine Division. 50% is something else. It's either here or elsewhere.
Reapers eluded.
Bothers me. Oh, they're right. I found it. It's right there.
Faster than light jump successful.
Will it still be
successful?
Will it still be lit up when I go back? I'm in the wrong side.
Reapers eluded.
Jesus. 300 units. I need to go right around them. No. Nope.
Yeah. Faster than light jump successful.
Nice, 100%. Bear with me, guys. I don't have enough fuel for this experiment, so I'm gonna go fuel up. A little hot chocolate. Fuel for the human as well. This wasn't there before, was it? Anadius? In the Horsehead Nebula? Wait. I just came here to fuel up. No! Alright, we're gonna divert over here first. The editor system. What's this? Chronos Station? There's no Reaper presence here. The MLA Red Supergiant Anidius is a minor footnote on the star maps of the Horsehead Nebula, a cold dying star of about 20 solar masses and 1500 times Sol's radius. Not listed on any charts, an unobtrusive space station is nearly imperceptible in the star's periodic bursts of solar output. ED's advisory. The size and shape of the station suggests many ships could dock in it. Precise measurements would require active scans, which could reveal the Normandy's presence. Given the stakes, this level of accuracy is not recommended. So if I scan this thing, that's bad. Oh, that was a weird sound. Saving the game and seeing what happens if I scan it. Nothing. Interesting. This might be a future quest over here. Because I swear, this was not here. I'm pretty sure around PAX there was nothing to see. It was just like, there was that red circle around the end, you know, the edge of the system, where you can't cross. That's so funny though. I just noticed that purely by accident. Okay, now I want to go back. Alright, that's where we're going next, communication hub. I just want to see what happens. Alright, so this is the mass relay. We are not going in it. We're traveling cluster travel. Enter system. That time it didn't happen. Going back. That's so weird. Oh, that was a weird glitch or something. Okay, heading for Kepler Verge then. Just one system. I just wanted to see if it would repeat itself. And it didn't. We'll look here, but we're not gonna land yet. I'm just gonna look at the rest in here. Anyway, this is the Newton system. This habitable world, Antaram, had been living in the shadow of disaster long before the Reaper War. Its moon's orbit is decaying, causing tidal disruptions and electrical storms before its eventual collision. When humans settled on Antaram, the Asari derided it as foolish. But today the humans look prescient. The communications hub they set up on the planet has hundreds of quantum communicators whose information is spread through broadcast on the planet and beamed out via comm buoy. While Antaram has yet to be attacked by Reaper forces, it's likely just a matter of time. I'm sure it is. Clencori? Clencori is a rock and ice planet with an atmosphere composed of chlorine, chlorine and argon. The frozen surface is mainly composed of potassium with deposits of iron. Glencroy is famously claimed by the eccentric Volus billionaire Kumon Shoal. His once ridiculed visions of beings of light protecting organic life from synthetic machine devils don't seem quite so far-fetched now. His private army of mercenaries are well established on the planet, waiting for Husk to come knocking on their door. In all likelihood, they will be obliterated by the molten metal of a Reaper orbital bombardment on its way to somewhere important. Burned. Juncrow. Juncrow is a hydrogen helium gas giant with traces of chlorine and sodium in its upper atmosphere. Like Uranus in the solar system, it is tipped on its side, its north pole facing the star Newton. And last, but maybe not least, Sesmos. Sesmos is an ice dwarf world. That's pretty cool looking. Its surface composed almost entirely of frozen water. Normally, a planetoid this small would not rate inclusion on the system's charts, but Sesmos's unusually large and beautiful ring of ice crystals have made it a popular subject for visual artists. The ring is the result of a glancing equatorial impact, which left a large trench and threw a large amount of melted water into the atmosphere. The rings are a temporary feature that will completely decay in a few thousand years. Well, that's all. Alright, let's look for stuff. I don't know if there's, anything in this system. But if there is, we'll find it, mister. I don't know, I had this weird idea that we were all done with N7 missions. I don't see anything. Like most quest systems, Reapers don't come. And these rings pretty far. Yeah, there's nothing here. If there is, I'd be very surprised, because... Okay. Another shorty. But next episode, N7. Well, Antaram for the N7 Communications Hub mission. Thanks for watching, guys. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.